Darua Nuna, Darua Nunawal, Yangu, Nagalawiri, Duninmanyan, Naganawuwari, Dawuwari, Ningada, Dindi, Wangarali, Jinyan. Today, we are meeting you from Ngunnawal and Ngambri country. We acknowledge and pay our respects to the elders. I also appreciate that many of you are joining us online from elsewhere. We acknowledge the country from where you are joining us and pay our respects to elders past and present and any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders who are with us here today. Today's seminar is entitled Investigating Australia's Undercover Geology Using the World's Largest Airborne Electromagnetic Survey. We have two presenters today. The first presenter will be Sebastian Wong. Sebastian is the Acting Activity Leader for National Geological Mapping at Geoscience Australia. He is responsible for the interpretation of AusAEM, Airborne Electromagnetic Survey, where he integrates a diverse range of geological and geophysical data sets to investigate the subsurface geology of Australia. The second presenter will be Alan Ewson Lee Cooper, who is a senior research scientist at Geoscience Australia and activity leader for Airborne Electromagnetics. He hopes to expand GA's scope on the diverse applications of AEM to widen and strengthen the organisation's capabilities and thinks of inversion theory and its derivations as an assessment tool to understand AEM measurements, the AEM instrumentation, and in assisting in the interpretation and predictions that follow. Without further ado, I'd like to invite Sebastian to the stage to begin.
Good day, everyone. Thanks for joining us. So Ewson and I are going to do something a little unconventional today. We would usually start one of these presentations with Ewson giving an introduction to the acquisition and inversion of AEM, but we're going to turn it on its head. I'm going to introduce the interpretation and then Ewson will move on to the acquisition and inversion. So I just want to acknowledge the people that have been involved directly with this interpretation and acquisition, and they're listed here. These are the people within Mineral Systems Branch and also the states and territories. But we also want to acknowledge that this work, the AusAEM is used in many other areas in GA and also externally. So if you're not aware, the AusAEM is the world's largest airborne electromagnetic survey. So what we're seeing here is the AusAEM 1 in Northern Territory and Queensland, the AusAEM 20 across the top of Northern Territory and Western Australia, and the AusAEM, AusAEM 2, and the AusAEM 20 down in the southern part of Western Australia. And superimposed over this is our interpretation of the AusAEM 1 survey. I'll let Ewson talk a bit more about this and the future acquisition. So to begin with, I want to just give you a very basic overview of electrical properties of earth materials. So this will help you understand the color maps that we're using in this presentation. So igneous and metamorphic rocks, this is very general. They're usually more resistive, so they'll be plotting in the cooler colors. Sandstones are resistive to moderately conductive, and they'll be plotting in these cool to warmer colors. The mudstones will be much more conductive and usually plotting in a more warm color in the reds here. And then we have massive sulfides where we get a lot of our base metals from, and they plot in the end of the spectrum of where they're very red and warm colors. And this is low conductivity and high electrical conductivity. However, this is also dependent on the degree of weathering. So there's a huge variation with rocks usually being more conductive when they're weathered. And also the porosity affects this, so the presence of groundwater with freshwater being resistive and saline water being more conductive. So if we look at this real-world example here, we have a conductive bed overlain by a more resistive bed, which is again overlain by a conductive bed. And so if we do our interpretation of that and assign stratigraphic and lithological information, we can see that these more conductive units are more clay-rich and the resistive units are more quartz-rich and resistive. And before I go any further, I just want to say that when we mention conductivity or resistivity during this talk, we're talking about electrical conductivity and resistivity. And when we're going to be shortening airborne electromagnetics to AEM. So the focus of my talk will be on the northern part of Australia, where we've completed the interpretation of the AusAEM-1 survey. When this was acquired, this was the world's largest AEM survey flown to date. It has a combined area of France and Germany at 1.1 million square kilometres, with approximately 60,000 line kilometres acquired at a nominal line spacing of 20 kilometres and a depth of investigation up to 500 metres. So when we're working at such a large scale, we found that the best resolution to work at is the geological error resolution. So if we take the North Australia Craton or North Australia study area into context, so that's the Proterozoic North Australia Craton overlain by Neoproterozoic to mostly Paleozoic sedimentary basins, Mesozoic sedimentary basins, and unconsolidated Cenozoic sediments and cover. And it's the delineation of the litho-electrical features that we can interpret as these major chronostratigraphic boundaries is what we set out to do. And so why is this important? Well, the overlying rocks, the Cenozoic and Mesozoic are prospective for minerals, energy and groundwater. However, the underlying older rocks are much more prospective for minerals and energy, and they also hold groundwater resources as well. So the AusAEM offers us a cost-effective, regional, non-invasive geophysical technique to investigate these. So another, just some other aims we set out to do. So while we're doing these interpretations, we're estimating cover thicknesses, we're re-evaluating basin boundaries. We're looking at paleo valleys because they have their prospective for groundwater, and we're looking at these discrete electrical conductors as these are could be related to those massive sulfides or host rocks that I mentioned earlier. So we've had to develop a new interpretation workflow for the interpretation of AusAEM data, and that's because of the requirement to capture and attribute a very large amount of interpretation-specific metadata, which we understand has never really been done before like this. And some of the information that we're collecting is stratigraphic information, stratigraphic units above and below the lines, and confidences and comments, and so on. And the stratigraphic information we're collecting is in line with the Australian Stratigraphic Units database. So when we do our interpretation, we don't do it in isolation. We take into account a lot of extra data. For example, the information in the multiplots, we have a depth of investigation. We have a inversion data misfit. We have spherics, which is lightning strikes, and also infrastructure such as power lines, as these can affect the data set. In our three-dimensional package, we also integrate the AusAEM with a lot of our other data sets, such as the potential fields, the gravity and magnetics, digital elevation models, surface geology, stratigraphic boreholes and petroleum wells, mineral occurrences and mines, infrastructure, and seismic. And a lot of these data sets I'm showing are available on the Geoscience Australia EFTF portal. So let's have a look at what we can see in the AusAEM. So if we look at this area, it's a very large area. It's over 400 kilometres by 300 kilometres. And it's in central Northern Territory. And we have a huge amount of this Cenozoic cover, which is the yellow to beige colours. And if you look at the locator map here, we can see that it's very extensive throughout Northern Territory and also Australia. We can see that there's some outcropping Proterozoic rocks and also little specks of outcropping Paleozoic rocks. So there must be some feature through here that's separating these. But our level of understanding at the moment is only based on this surface geology. But when we bring in the AEM, we can see that there's clearly a structure through there separating these more resistive bedrock from a more conductive rock here. So we can interpret that as a fault. If we go back to our locator map here, we can see a data set done by Korsch and Dublier, a major crustal boundaries, is showing a Willora suture, which matches this almost identically. So this is actually north to the left of the screen on the major image here. And what we're seeing there is, we've interpreted that as a near surface expression of this Willora suture, which can be used for mapping neotectonic structures and could also be used for hazard mapping. So in the locator map here, we can also see that there's some offset in the DEM, and this is can be interpreted as potential geologically recent movement along this fault. We can also map stratigraphic units, and what we're looking at here is stratigraphic units in the Lander Trough in the Wiseau Basin. And if we just bring back the cover, this is showing that we can start to think about these things in an undercover mapping sense. But it's not only limited to these major structures and stratigraphic units. Some of the near surface basins, such as the Paleo Valleys, have been mapped previously by Geoscience Australia. However, when this data set was released, they did not have access to the AusAEM. So if we look at these Paleo Valleys through here, and we bring the AusAEM in again, we can see these conductive horizons overlying the resistive rocks. If we do our interpretation of that based on our integrated workflow, we can start to really think of these things in a three-dimensional volumetric sense. And we can, when we bring back that data set, we can see that there's areas where we can definitely revise the distribution of these things undercover quite significantly, and also look at their connectivity. So if these things are groundwater conduits, then their connectivity is very important. And finally, if we just bring the cover back on, this just shows how we're really moving to a mapping the undercover and working towards a national geological framework. So I'm just going to show you some examples of how we can use the AusAEM as an exploration tool or support exploration. So in this area we have, it's an old map and there's some copper mines on there. But if we bring on a more recent data set of major mines and mineral occurrences, we can see that they're potentially structurally controlled as they fall on faults and within folds. So if we bring in the potential fields, so the magnetics here, we can see that they're associated with these anomalies and on the boundaries of them. And in the gravity, we can also see that they're potentially associated with these gravity ridges. And as those potential fields data sets that are used for most for more detailed targeting exploration, such as drilling, but now we have a new data set, a geophysical data set. So we can see here that these conductors are likely related to these structures. And if they are related to those mineralization or the mineralization, then we can map these things extending undercover. But importantly, the AusAEM is flown as a regional survey. It covers not only these areas where it's highly explored, but also areas where are less explored. And if we look up strike of these major faults through here and jump across to the next line, 20 kilometres away, we see similar electrical conductors in the subsurface. Now, this is really important because an explorer has gone out and drilled these things, this one here, and they've had a technical discovery where they've hit some copper. So that's great news for the AusAEM. Looking at a bit larger scale, so we're in the eastern succession of Mount Isa area, so we're looking at Cloncurry area here, sorry. If we bring on the mines and mineral occurrences, we can see they're very much concentrated where the Proterozoic rocks outcrop, and very little of them where the Cenozoic and Mesozoic cover exists, with the exception of some few, such as Ernest Henry, which is mining through approximately 40 metres of that cover. But if we bring in the AusAEM, we can start to see that there's these discrete electrical conductors that could be associated with this mineralisation or their host rocks, and they extend undercover. So this shows that the AusAEM can be used to map the distribution of some of these electrical conductors undercover. However, this also shows some of the weaknesses of the AusAEM, because we have a depth of investigation that's up to 200 metres where we have this conductive cover, but the signal can't penetrate any further through there. So this is just showing some of the strengths and weaknesses of the AusAEM. Now, when we're thinking about cover, if we look at this area, we've got the mineralised Mount Isa Proterozoic rocks overlain by the Georgina Basin. Now, the Georgina Basin is much more resistive than our previous example, and we can actually map through that. So if we put on the Georgina Basin boundary and then bring in the AusAEM, we can start to see there's these west dipping features in the AusAEM. If we do our interpretation of that using our integrated workflow, then we can actually map the three-dimensional structure of this contact. If we bring back the cover, you can see how we're now able to map through that Georgina Basin and really start to think about the depth to the mineralized basement. And this is also important because in this area there's phosphate rocks being associated with the boundary of the Georgina basement, but now we're actually mapping that boundary in three dimensions too. Another example of how we can use this as an exploration tool with data integration. So here we have a lot of magnetic rocks separated from this less magnetic zone by maybe a major fault. We can see that they're also very electrically conductive. We've got a great correlation, similar correlation in the gravity as well. And if we look at this area here in greater detail, the AEM section is showing a highly conductive unit through there, and which is also intersected by a borehole. If we look at the magnetics, we can see that the AEM and this borehole both intersect this highly magnetic zone. If we bring in the surface geology, the outcropping rocks here are a pyritic black carbonaceous shale. Now, this makes a lot of sense because if it's got sulfides in it and it's a carbonaceous shale, well, then we have a very conductive unit. And if there's sulfides in there as well, then there might be magnetite and pyrrhotite causing this highly magnetic feature here. So we've got a great correlation by many data sets here. And we can use that to map the distribution of this unit undercover from where it outcrops in this box here to over 50 kilometres to the north and over 150 kilometres to the south-southeast, up to 200 metres of Mesozoic cover is overlying this in some areas, and it's resistive, so we can actually map through that. And importantly, over 150 kilometres to the south-southeast, we have outcropping rocks of the same group. So this really helps us to make that connection. So if rocks such as this are found to have economic significance, then the AusAEM can be used with the integration of other data sets to broaden our search areas, constrain targets, and reduce exploration risk. Now, I'm just going to show you an example of a scale reduction workflow that has been developed here at GA by many people in the mineral systems branch. And I'm going to focus on the electrical methods that have been used in this and some geophysics. So in this area in east of Tennant Creek, we have a lot of Cenozoic cover and some Paleozoic rocks, the Georgina Basin outcropping, but we're more interested in the underlying Proterozoic rocks. So if we take an electrical technique, so the long period magnetotellurics from AusLamp. We're looking at the 20-kilometer slice here, and we see that there's this rough north northeast southwest trending conductor through there. If we look at the potential fields, so in the magnetics and the gravity, we can see that there is this this similar north northeast southwest trending structure. And we can also see that there's potentially a zone of shallower rocks through here. Now, we've also acquired magnetotellurics, broadband magnetotellurics in this area, and we can see the extension of a deep conductor coming up to the near surface. And so AEM has also been acquired through this area, which is looking at the near surface conductivity of these features. So if we look at this area in greater detail, and if we can see that conductor extending to the surface. If we strip off the potential fields and the magnetotellurics, we can see there's a discrete electrical conductor in the AusAEM. If we zoom in that in more detail, so this unit, this horizon was targeted for a drill hole that was drilled in collaboration between Geoscience Australia and the National Drilling Initiative. And they hit a zone where this conductive horizon exists of mineralized pyrite, chalcopyrite, and arsenopyrite, which has a 0.4% copper. So this is a great example of how we can use scalar reduction as a exploration tool. And also the team has credited the AusAEM as the tool that's helped to look at where this conductor is expressed at the near surface. So I'm going to change gears a bit. So we're moving into energy. So hydrogen is very much the flavor of the month. And so the storage has been highlighted as a challenge that we're faced. So the salt diapiric structures have been identified as potential storage sites. And so if we look at this feature here, we can, this is a data set off the Western Australia WAPIMS. And so we can see this is a mapped salt diapiric structure, and we can see it in the magnetics and the gravity running through there. However, if we look at that, the AusAEM, we can see a disruption of this flat-lying bed, these horizontal conductors. If we map them, and then bring back on the WAPIMS data set, we can see that they correlate very well with this this data. So we're now able, we can now see that we can map these salt diapiric structures in the AusAEM. So we've gone ahead and done this very preliminary work, but we've mapped some of them in strategically important areas near the coast, some that can be mapped very well in the AusAEM, some that we can quite significantly extend their distribution from their previously mapped sites using the AusAEM, and others that we can map really well with our integrated workflow of integrating it with many other data sets. Now, some stuff that could be relevant to groundwater. So this is a machine learned cover thickness model, not cover thickness model, it's a machine learned conductivity model. From 0 to 500 millimeters in the subsurface, and we can start to see some of these conductive paleo valleys and some seawater intrusion at the coast. And this is really important for management of groundwater dependent ecosystems, management of groundwater in general, and also for industries such as mining and agriculture. I'm just going to step through the AusAEM 1 interpretation as this has been completed and show you what we've actually been able to map in the subsurface. So this is the AusAEM interpretation in all its glory, but if we want to start stepping through that, so if we remove the minor faults, major faults, and the three electrical conductors, we are left with the major chronostratigraphic boundaries that we set out to map at the very beginning. So if we just start stripping some of that off, so the Cenozoic is now going to be stripped off the Carpentaria and Eromanga Basin, off the Georgina and Wiser Basin, and off the Aileron Province. Now we're looking at some of the pre-Cenozoic rocks. So we can strip the Mesozoic rocks off to expose the Paleozoic Georgina Basin, and then we can strip the Georgina and Wiseau Basin and some of the Amadeus Basin Paleozoic rocks off. And now we're left with some of the oldest rocks in the interpretation. So we've got Neoproterozoic in the north of the Georgina and in the Amadeus, which is gone, and the pre-Neoproterozoic rocks. And so we've collected almost 200,000 depth estimate points, which we've attributed with that large amount of metadata. This line work are available in the portal. We're making this data set available in various 3D formats that can be used in various 3D software. They'll be stored in the EGGS database, which I'll touch on in a second. And if you want to read up about this more, there's the EFTF extended abstract, and an ECAT record is being published very soon. So I'm just going to quickly touch on the estimates of geological and geophysical surfaces database. So we store our depth estimate points in EGGS, and these data are available at the portal. And we extract these points to create our cover thickness models, which we create for each of those depth slices that I mentioned at the beginning. And these are in turn used for in our mineral potential mapper and our economic fairways tool, which is a minerals extraction economic viability tool. Thank you. I'll leave it at that, and I'll hand it over to Yusen.
All right. Thank you, Seb. Just before I start, I'd like Dave already touched on the acknowledgement to a number of people that walked this land before us. But I also would like to extend my acknowledgement to all the other First Nations of the lands we have flown over, and other First Nations that might be listening online around the world. So as Seb explained, we're going to change the gears. I hope he's enticed you with some beautiful pictures and unveiling the features undercover, showing how the AusAEM has this fabulous capacity to map undercover for hundreds of kilometers. But now I'm gonna hopefully get your attention to take you behind the scenes, open the bonnet and see how these beautiful curtains are done and all the work that goes to the development of that modeling. So I'll just touch very briefly on inversion. An inversion is not a word to be scared of. It's not a dark art. It's actually a very well-fundamented mathematical and physical connection that allows us to model what we can't see. In a continent like Australia, where 80% of our rocks are undercover, we need geophysical techniques and inversion to try and map what lays beneath. So I'll break it down in what I call the ABC of airborne electromagnetics. It's composed of, let's say, three components. One is the data acquisition, where we fly an aircraft with a sensor over the ground. Depends, we can use two sorts of platforms, helicopter or fixed wing. And all we're doing is we are measuring how electricity decays with time. So at the speed of light, we're pulsing this ground and seeing how the materials underneath allow or not the electricity to travel through them. So that's the acquisition part. Then the inversion part is where we group our physical knowledge, use some well-known mathematical equations, and we transform these values of voltage, so how voltage decays with time, to how things vary with depth. So you can see conductivity varying here to the right, and how we're going deeper, and you can see a conductor there, right? So this is on an individual level, a sounding. That's one location on the Earth at a specific part. We stitch all of these together and we build these geoelectrical models. So that's a stitched line of several of these conductivity soundings and colored according to the scale that Seb showed previous. Now, don't be scared of this. There's several models that fit the data. That's no problem. We need to learn to live with uncertainty. That is a thing that we are embracing, and we can assess now the model. So there's several models, same models that fit the data, and it's okay. We can throw statistics at this and then assess the certainty or not of these inversions. That's something that we have more recently incorporated into our group with some acquisitions of some brilliant people and just within our workflow, right? And then finally, the pretty pictures, the geology, how we go from how current is flowing to the ground to geology. And it was lovely. I love the stories around the discrete conductors and where the valleys are filled with potential groundwater. So the reality is we don't know the full capacity of where these data sets will be used. We do a very good job in GA archiving these data sets and storing them for future generations. The reality is we don't know the full potential of these. We continue to find people using them for different purposes that we don't even conceive. And I'll show you a little piece of data sets from other parts of the world soon. Okay, so very basic. This will be probably boring by now, but that it must be shown. So how does it work? It works by electromagnetic induction. So you can see a transmitter is a coil here, and then we have a receiver. Yes, we vary the primary field, which in turn induces the secondary currents in the conductive body. Yes. The strength of that secondary field depends on the conductivity of those properties of those underlying materials. So a little cartoon of how this works. There's the transmitter. It's beaming this pulse to the ground. It's interacting with the earth-forming materials. And there's one of our guys, maybe Ian Roach, in his induction logger, trying to ground truth the response of the AEM signal. So in a nutshell, and this is how I try to explain it to my kids, we're making images from observations. So we're transforming numbers to colors, right? So because of the inductive nature and the diffusive physical nature of AEM methods, we see in this animation, as we go deeper, our circular of influence grows. So then we lose resolution as we go deeper, right? And we do that at different depths. That's how we discretize the ground and for different stations. Once again, we go there from a stitched 1D inversion image on the bottom, this section, to an informed conductivity section of geology. Right, now AEM inversion, and please don't be scared of this. I'll try to explain this to the best of my capacities. In red here is the data. That's how we record data decaying with time, right? So to some extent, the closer the data is to the surface, the early time we're extending it, right? And this is just the response, an amplitude response. On the right, I've got, once again, those conductivity and depth models. So this is a half space. So you can see what we mean with a half space is that the conductivity is a straight line. It's just as if you were looking through a big, thick, let's say, block of ice or something. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to let this inversion work. So I want to show you how I'm going to try and fit this blue line to the data set and try to drive this with a series of iterations, so that's the amount of times I let this work, to a normalized misfit. What that means is I'm just trying to take it to an objective that I predetermine where I can say the data is properly fit. So this is how it goes. You can see after iteration 7, we're starting to fit the data, then some layers of conductivity appear, right? And you can see there's one layer, we're fitting the data better, that's closer to 1. Once it hits 1, it stops, all right? And these layers that appear here on the right is what we stitched to produce these beautiful images underneath. So the final model from what we call a deterministic model is when we hit the objective function to go below 1, right? And we consider that we're fitting the data and we say, okay, that's good enough. Take that as a model. What we do with the stochastic methods, with the Bayesian methods, is we do this over hundreds of thousands of times to get a series of models that all satisfy the data. Okay, so this is a nice slide put together by Anand for us. And I'm going to take you to Antarctica because that's quite topical. So on the left, you see a line flown over permafrost. So it's a glacier. It was data collected with NSF, that's the National Sanitation Fund, which is a big organization in the US. And they funded this survey. What it does is it shows you a conductor, a channel that was never seen before. It's here where the laser pointer is. This previous line was found previously, but this channel was never seen before. So what are these panels? These panels, instead of one inversion, one model, have been constructed with hundreds of thousands of models at each location. So that's why we have what is called the fifth percentile of conductivity, the 50th percentile, the mean conductivity, and the 95th percentile. So things that vary too much, you probably don't trust, okay? Things that are consistent with all the sections, in a nutshell, are more trustworthy, let's say. And on the right, this is beautiful. The guys were sending us data in the Great Artesian Basin, and Anand was looking at them overnight. So we were extracting, look at the beautiful geology here, right? Those dipping beds as they were producing. This let us have full control of what they were acquiring, which actually led to a refly of some lines. We're moving to real time uncertainty quantification, which is fantastic. Of course, we have access to the NCI, which stands for the National Computational Infrastructure, which allows us to very powerful compute nodes. And we've got a little module, a working group, for the external audience. EFTF stands for Exploring for the Future. And the HiQ module is a high quality geophysical analysis team, which is developing these tools, not only for EFTF, but for GA in general. So we're focusing on AEM, but the possibility is much wider than that. Okay, so a few pretty pictures of AEM systems. I'll run through that. AEM systems are very bespoke acquisition systems. The electronics move very fast with time, so the contract providers have been modifying the systems. This is a Finnish system that flew with two coils here. They flew the whole of Finland, and now we got the Finns come visit here a few years ago, some of you might remember, and now they saw our method, so they want to go and refly. So this looks like a Hilsholtz. This is kind of someone rigged one of these systems, this Australian invention. This is one, was the old Tempest. It's changed its platform. That's a geotem flowing over Canada. This that looks like the Dreamcatcher is actually a SkyTem developed by our colleagues, the Danes. Our Tempest flying here, this is a photo we took out of Alice Springs. The Excite, and there's many more, right? But I just wanted to show you the complexity. And I wanted to share a beautiful note. In one of our recent surveys, a member of the public, Rang Wayne, which is who's our stakeholder engagement, and he said, I really would like to know when your plane is flying over our land, because my grandchildren would like to take a picture of this system flying. So it's these systems and their quirkiness spark a lot of conversations, interesting conversations with our stakeholders. So why is this important? Every different system has a different response. And check the paint job here on the spectrum. That's a South African system that's flown for us here in Australia. And all what I'm trying to show you here is the different systems will measure a different response. Here I've got a simple three-layer model, and you can see the different data you acquire from those systems. That's all I want to show there. What's happened is through time, GA has played an important role on establishing standards. We've been using AEM, and now we are the world's largest agency in acquisition of AEM. So we had to get it right from the beginning. So we've played an important role in transforming AEM data from just bump detection or qualitative assessment to something quantitative. To do that, we've gone through a series of processes like understanding these systems. We've got some very firm technical documentations where the providers have agreed to talk to us and disclose some of their proprietary filters and kind of tricks and trades to give them the competitive advantage, right? So what we've done is we've established a calibration range. This is in the Menindee Lakes, and you can see those black dots are boreholes. We've got some passive seismic, and we get them basically to fly this line every time a new system comes into the country and was going to fly for a government agency. We have a conversation with them, and that we say, well, we kind of think we know what's underneath. So you have to prove that you are undisclosing your modeling and your processing on your data, so we can emulate it, right? This has enabled a series of collaborations. We have some good chats with the USGS. Now they're flying AEM all over California to secure their groundwater resources. The Mississippi, people from GSWA also, CSIRO, the Mali CMA, and a few others, but it's been a great enabler of collaboration. So I'll show you an example. These are four lines, and the lines Seb was showing you are sometimes 900 kilometers. This is only 8 kilometers, right? So we have much more control, right? So these are four different systems. You can see, I'll switch back. You can see that's the lake here. That's the Menindee Lake. And look at that. Yeah, you can see the lake there very clearly. That's the four different systems. Overall, you are recovering the same structure, I believe. And if you don't believe me, we send Dion Roach again with his borehole logging tool. And we've color-coded it the same. So just look at that. I mean, that is, for me, fairly convincing evidence of ground truthing. And this line is the same as the previous, but a new system came, a new kid on the block wanted to try its luck with us. So we got him to fly over the line, and we will accumulate whoever wants to fly a range. We're establishing a new calibration in Perth, which is closer to where the providers have most of their instrumentation. Okay, so this slide is kind of my condensing slide that tries to sum the concepts that I've thrown together. And this is one piece of data. So we have an X and a Z component. What does that mean? So when we're measuring the electric field, it has an influence in a three-dimensional space. So we measure with three coils, X, Z, and Y, or whatever framework you want to use. Here I'm only showing the X and Z component, but is the variations of the electric field in two directions, what I'm showing here, but we measure them in three directions, right? So that's how it is. It's how the response decays with time. We do a 1D inversion. And we color them according to the conductivity value we have derived. We then stitch these to create those beautiful sections and curtains for each line. In some occasions where there's enough close distance between the line, we stitch the models and create conductivity values, layers, and then we take it to 3D, right? Then we get the human is still important. So we've got Givo and Ian Roach having a look at our sections there and putting them into the geological context, right? It's very important. Okay, now I want to go a little bit to the past because I'm a bit of a romantic, melancholic person somewhat. And I was having a conversation with Alistair, who we're very grateful. Alistair is a person who's been in Geoscience Australia for who you might not know him, and has been working here for a long time, and he's a very knowledgeable man. So he pointed me to, he listens to our conversations and I think he must laugh and said, we've done this before, you guys. And he sent me a paper he wrote about all his learnings in GA. And here on the left, he showed me, he put in this paper, what I called, it's the mapping of the central desert in Australia. Here it's a 1,500 kilometer by 1,000 kilometer mapping campaign, which began in 1950s, imagine, and they finished in 1979. What I'm trying to pull at and what I want to try to take the attention of you guys is that the airborne side of things has been weaved into GA without us probably not knowing. So what Alistair and what this paper shows is that because this is a very vast continent, it's very hard to get access to all these places, even after mapping for 30 years. So they relied on aerial photographs, right? And I've got a few notes here, which Alistair wrote in this paper, said, the program arose of the Australian government's realization during the Second World War that knowledge of Australia's petroleum and mineral resources was merged and scatter, and that the exploration of these commodities needed systematic geological mapping. Aerial photography of the continent started at this time and proved to be indispensable for mapping. And you can see those beautiful structures that are at surface, right? And a little bit of the correlation, some of the workflows that Alistair describes are still with us. And you can see those are what they called photo runs, which was actually the aircraft taking photos in one direction, then the other direction. That sounds like our planning of lines and then collating them, fastening them in glider clips to overlap correctly. I think this is incredible. It's really important. And we must have those photos somewhere there. So they would create these mosaics and then start planning for their mapping, right? As you can see there. In correlation, or the counterpart, is that same area is what Seb showed as the AusAEM one. It's a little bit larger. We started flying in 2017 and completed in 2018. But to be fair, the interpretation continues, right? It's and I hope it will continue for a long time. But it just gives you a sense of the coverage we're gaining with this new technique. And then on the right, similar to that beautiful photo with structure, Wayne put this image together for me. It's a hill-shaded digital elevation model, which is combined with radiometrics. And the AEM shows that second dimension and the deformation there. So now we can see not only things that are available to everyone with a photograph, the things that lay below, right? So that's where I wanted to go. And just continue with the tradition, and you'll see this makes sense. But for the last 60 years, GA with our state and territory partners have systematically merged geophysical surveys. A lot of people are very familiar with these three data sets, the magnetic, the gravity, and the radiometrics, and we give them for granted. And we have no idea how privileged we are. It's a huge country, and it's one of the only countries in the world that has this data coverage, right? To give you a few pointers of what this means, these are look now like beautiful seamless grids, and my colleagues, out there, Phil and Yvette and James and all the people in the GABS team have and play an important role here, right? So to put things into perspective, back in 2007, there was a survey that was flown north-south, yeah? And they flew the whole country at 75 Ks apart with ties at 400 Ks. This allowed us to merge all those surveys into one seamless map. If we didn't, we would have the patchwork you can see on the right here in the radiometrics. Similarly, there's been acquisition of gravity stations with over 2 million points, and don't quote me on these numbers, you can go and talk to Phil about them, but over 67 years. That means some person has taken a gravity reading at some location within 11 Ks or nearer. That's an amazing task, I think. So why is this important? Because we are just building on the legacy of others, right? I would like to mention two very important people here that were instrumental in the compilation of the national data sets. One is Richard Lane, who is no longer with us, but was important in this. And of course, Brian Minty. And yes, so there's many others, of course. So here, I'm gonna just try and show you the national coverage that we currently have with AEM and drive you a little bit through the history. We had some early trials in 1994 to 2000. Then we had some salinity mapping surveys there in 2000. They're very small, and you can see the grandeur of the latest surveys and how they're increasing with time. We have close to national coverage now, 60%. That's more than the whole European Union. It's a big achievement, a lot of work. I think just to finish here, the take-home message is, this is an image that was pulled together by Malcolm and the portal team. All our data sets are available from there. You can jump in the portal and that'll click to the ECAT record. You can download them. They're all of GA's data is free. I think the important message is AEM is non-invasive. You can see the widespread coverage it takes. Applications are wide and vast, mineral energy, groundwater, environment, hazard mapping. I put ice thickness there in small because we're not gonna do much of that in Australia. I don't, well, maybe, but cover modeling, depth debasement, And just to finish, Ross went over to Queensland a few weeks ago, and he sent me a picture of a fossil. So this is incredible, because I think it's important, and that recognition of the past and the present is really important, because this proves that a big creature with those features was swimming in this, was an inland ocean at some point, and its remains got stuck there in some sedimental structure. So it's where I wanted to finish. And that's all for now. Thanks.
So thank you to Sebastian and Yusen for that presentation. I'm just going to see if I can get the online questions up. Here we go. But as we do so, can I check first if there's any questions from the floor, perhaps? We do have a couple of minutes for questions. Yeah, sure. Carole.
Thanks. That was an excellent talk. Wonderful to divorce. So it's amazing where it's come to in terms of you've got 20-kilometer line spacing. And tell me if I'm wrong, but I think we were called mad when we started by some people. My question to you is, has everybody bought it now? Has everybody kind of sees the value of the 20 kilometers, or where should we put our emphasis? Should we keep acquiring 20 kilometers, or should we be stepping in?
So before you launch in and answer that question, I'm going to repeat it for the people online, and I'll ask one of you to come up here and ask it. So the question from the floor was, AusAEM flies at a 20-kilometre line spacing, and the question is asking our presenters if people are buying into that as valuable to the industry, noting that in the original proposals, there were some questions about how valuable that would be. So,
Thanks for the question, Carole. I think people have bought into it. We never set out to use it as a direct detector, although Seb showed the value of it and how it can be done. And there's various other industry examples that by serendipitous means we had happened to fly over goodies that have proven to be good mineralized conductors, for instance. The answer is yes, we've still got 60% to go. So let's get the funds to finish the national coverage. And then we will talk about flying in at higher resolution. Some of the states are very keen, Western Australia has done a great job at selling the benefits, and that's why they need to have the coverage of the whole state. Yes?
So I was up at Northern Territory Geological Survey, and they asked where would they suggest do further infill, and I think my suggestion to them was actually, rather than do that, put your funds into the 20-kilometer line spacing, because that way you can gain that regional understanding of the geology. And if you want to do further infill later, at least you've got a complete backdrop to use as a targeting. So I think it's great for that regional picture.
So I might take a couple of questions quickly online, and maybe that's a good segue to the first of these I see in front of us. What's next when you get to 100% coverage? Is it the infill or is it something else? Sebastian, do you want to come back up and take it?
That's a great question. Look, I think it would be from the data acquisition, it will be going on to the interpretation. So if we've got a complete coverage of Australia, then how do we interpret that? Because it takes a lot of time to interpret. We are working on some tools for maybe semi-automated interpretation, and also getting uncertainties from the data So I think it will be more a shift towards developing tools that can help us get a better understanding of the national coverage.
Okay, thanks, Sebastian. Maybe just one more. So from Mark Hoggard here, acknowledging this as a phenomenal achievement and asking you to comment on the potential effects of electrical anisotropy and or flight line structure on your current inversion results. And also, are you using regularization within the inversion? This looks like a question for you, Sam.
It's actually a fantastic question for Anand, but I'm going to take it. yes, of course, we use regularization. Of course, there is 2 and 3 defects, DFX in some parts of the data. We have found, and I will repeat this, that we can fit most of the data with a 1D Earth approximation. And not to bore everyone else, we can talk to Mark on the side. But yes, of course, we do regularize our inversions. We are building different capabilities. So the stochastic inversion you'll see more and more of. What we've shown mostly here is just a 1 deterministic inversion, but we are building tools around assessing these different things. I think that I'll leave it there. Yes.
Thanks, Yusen. And I guess just a reminder not to be scared of inversion. I think that came up a couple of times. Look, I will call it time because we are out of time. But look, thank you again to our presenters. Perhaps you could join me again in thanking them. And just a quick update, there will be no GA seminar for the next few weeks. Internally in GA, we have some all-staff meetings taking place next week. So I encourage all of our staff to participate in that. And then we run into the school holidays. So if you're interested in learning of the upcoming presentations, I encourage you to look online, and that will be posted into the chat for those joining us outside. Otherwise, thank you all for your time.